What if I told you that this can of Pringles is a computer? By simply adding and removing chips, we have turned it into a data structure that computers rely on constantly, the stack. And just like a real computer, this stack can store values, run functions, and ultimately execute any type of code. In this video, we will learn exactly why it works and how to construct one from scratch. So grab a can of Pringles and stick around. A stack follows a simple rule: last in, first out. The last chip placed in the can is always the first to be eaten. But today we are not looking at the data structure itself, but rather the call stack, also known as an execution stack. When your program runs, the call stack keeps track of which function is running, what arguments it got, and where to return to. Each Pringle represents 4 bytes of information you can store. You can push a Pringle on the stack, or pop a Pringle off it. This call stack is part of a chunk of memory the operating system allocates for program execution. It is one of 4 main regions, and together with just 3 pointers, the instruction, stack, and base pointer, we can compute. So let's see what actually happens when we run this C program. Here we have an add function that takes 2 arguments and returns the sum. The main function calls add with 5 and 7, returns 0, and terminates. But in reality, computers don't work with such high-level languages. They transform them into machine code. But we humans can't really make good sense of it, so let's work with assembly instead. Each instruction resides in a specific memory address. As we step through each of them, we'll also track the 3 pointers and how they interact with the stack. To help us understand the stack better, let's switch to a view of the inside of our can. We also mark out each memory region at intervals of 4 bytes, which is the amount of information each Pringle stores. Now, we bring back some instructions and explore the purpose of our pointers. The instruction pointer always points to the next instruction to be executed. The stack pointer, always to the top of the stack, and the base pointer is a marker for where the first Pringle of a function is. But the pointers don't do anything on their own. We need to execute some instructions. To run any function, it starts with a setup procedure. For main, we first push the base pointer into our stack to save it. We will see why this is so important later on. Every time we have a new Pringle in the can, we decrement our stack pointer to keep it pointing at the top. And upon every instruction execution, we need to update our instruction pointer to read the next one. Here, we mark where the first Pringle of the main function is, using a move instruction. This assigns the value of our stack pointer to our base pointer. Remember how our C code had a result variable in the main function? That will be stored on the stack, so let us allocate some space. An integer is 4 bytes, so we decrement our stack pointer accordingly. This Pringle here now becomes the placeholder for result, which will be empty until we execute the add function later. This series of instructions is known as the function prologue, the introduction of a function. Like any good story, the end of an introduction is followed by the body. Here, the add function is to be called, and the return value will be stored in result. But before it can do its work, it needs its arguments. We then use 2 move instructions to load the values 5 and 7 into 2 CPU registers, R0 and R1. They are then pushed onto the stack from the registers, with the second argument pushed before the first. Remember, this is because of the last in, first out property. Now, we are ready to execute the add function itself. The call instruction first stores the next pending instruction in main we have yet to execute. This Pringle is important as we will rely on it to know which instruction to return to after executing an inner function like add. After this checkpoint is on our stack, the instruction pointer shifts to the first instruction in add. At this point, we see that all the Pringles in the stack between the base and stack pointer belong to the main function. This is known as a stack frame, a section that belongs to a function. The add function prologue begins and we push the base pointer to the stack and make the base pointer point to where the stack pointer is pointing at. The prologue ends and the arguments passed into the function are now loaded into registers R2 and R3 for computation. This is done through the move instructions, which read the value at base pointer plus 8 bytes and base pointer plus 12 bytes. This was where 5 and 7 were stored. The finishing touch is the add instruction, which adds the values in registers R2 and R3, giving 12, and stores it in R0, our return register. And that's the job done for the add function. The question now is, how do we wrap up this inner function and go back to executing the outer one, which is main? The answer lies in the function epilogue. For every beginning, there's an end. And with any function prologue, there's an epilogue. Here, it consists of three steps. Firstly, we have a move instruction that moves the stack pointer to point at where the base pointer is. This is done to unreserve space used for a function's local variables. But since there is none, there isn't a change. Secondly, we pop the base pointer. We remove the topmost sprinkle, look at the value written on it, and set the base pointer to point at that location. The stack pointer is incremented to remain pointing at the top of the stack. Finally, we return and the function epilogue finishes. We read the stored instruction location in the stack and set the instruction pointer to it, which is 0x0020. This is the next instruction after call add. We increment the stack pointer again to remove the topmost sprinkle. Every time we increment the stack pointer, we are performing a cleanup operation. Whatever Pringles that is above the stack pointer is no longer part of our concern. We have an add instruction that increments the stack pointer by 8 bytes, destroying two Pringles that stored the arguments passed into add. Remember the result placeholder we had at this memory location? Well, now we move the value from register R0 to that exact place, base pointer minus 4. At this point, there is no more code in main to execute. What we have left is to prepare to return 0. So, we move the value 0 to register R0 and begin the function epilogue of main. Similarly, the stack pointer is set to the base pointer, removing the Pringle storing the value of result. We perform the instruction to pop the base pointer, which moves both the stack and base pointer to where it all began, ending with a return. The stack is empty, and the main function epilogue is also complete, thus the whole program terminates successfully. To recap, we learned about the call stack using Pringles, we saw how it works hand-in-hand with the instruction pointer, stack pointer, and base pointer to execute a function. We also learned about the function prologue and epilogue. But what happens when the stack isn't functioning as it's supposed to? What happens when the stack is full? Imagine we have a poorly written factorial function. Here, we perform the function calls recursively, but do not have a base case. So, say we call factorial 3, the Pringles for the stack frame of factorial 3 will be pushed on the stack. Then factorial 2, 1, 0, negative 1, and so on. Infinitely. Since our Pringle can, the call stack is limited in size, the Pringles overflow eventually. This is known as a stack overflow. This leads to memory corruption and causes an error like segmentation fault. That's it, now you know how to build a call stack from scratch. So next time when you eat your can of Pringles, remember that the power of creating a computer is in your hands. Or you can enjoy your snack and head down to Brilliant to learn more about computers, the sponsor who made this video possible. Brilliant helps you become a better thinker and problem solver, with thousands of visual interactive lessons in math, science, programming, data analysis, and AI. The digital circuits course is a really interesting one that gives you a hands-on experience visualizing various logic gates, which is a great way to help build problem-solving skills. As someone who hates memorizing, having these interactive courses really keeps things lighthearted. Starting from truth tables to even building adders, it really is a progressive learning system, which helps you learn just a bit more daily without feeling overwhelmed. To learn for free on Brilliant, go to brilliant.org/graphicode. Scan the QR code on screen or click on the link in the description. Brilliant's also given our viewers 20% off an annual premium subscription, which gives you unlimited daily access to everything on Brilliant. Thank you for watching till the end as always, and your support that helps me create more videos.